Hello to everyone joining us on our ITV Life Skills channel. I hope you're all having a good day today. Today we're joined by Dr. Anukant, who is a scientist with extensive research experience in multiple medical fields like immunology, oncology, virology, vaccine development, and so on. The original discoverer of a robotic vaccine discovery technology from the world's best Harvard Medical University, Boston, USA, Dr. Anukant is going to tell us more about the COVID-19 coronavirus and how we can safeguard ourselves. First of all, how are you doing today, doctor?
Doing very well. Okay. Thank you for contacting me.
Sure. So I want to ask you, since you're an expert in virology, everyone is living in such a fear today. Everyone is too scared. So what can you tell the people about this virus in simple words so that everyone can understand easily?
It's a microorganism, tinier than the bacteria. It's not an independent organism, therefore it cannot live on its own. Bacteria can live on its own. It is a single cellular organism, but virus is not a single cellular organism. It needs to infect some other living species and get into a cell and make use of the cellular mechanism to survive. Therefore, the virus becomes alive only after entering into a cell. Until then, it is a non-living material. It is easy to destroy the virus outside, or it may even die on its own. It's one virus, even if it is there for thousands of years, it's going to be one virus if it is not dead. But the moment it gets into a living cell, like a human or other animal or plant or insect, anything, they multiply into billions in hours. That is all you have to know about the virus.
Okay, thank you. The next question I have is, there are so many numbers every day. Numbers of deaths per city, number of deaths per country, and these numbers are in hundreds of thousands. So are these numbers true? Are there really so many people who are dying because of this coronavirus?
The numbers about dead people may be true. But again, it is questionable because how many of them have been tested to be positive to this virus, we do not know. There is another conspiracy theory that is running around that the original primers used for testing COVID-19 were not targeted to the COVID-19 virus. Instead, it has been designed to PCR amplify the influenza virus, and the American people have all been immunized. Most of the Americans have been immunized for influenza. In those people, if you test it with the primer that can detect an influenza virus, then will become positive. Therefore, we do not know how far that conspiracy is true. But if the test have been done with the PCR and found to be positive and the people die, then that number is true. But we do not know how many of the people who have been tested so far. Therefore, non-infected people are really non-infected people. Are they infected and they carry the virus asymptomatic? We do not know.
Okay. So there was a viral video going around recently. I think you must have seen it. It's about a nurse in New York City who was seen crying because she stated that the doctors are purposefully killing the patients in the hospital. Now, I think that is quite possible in private hospitals. It's expected from such medical institutes. But what would you say is the way out of this? If people want to go to the hospitals for treatment and the doctors and nurses are creating such medical malpractice, where do we go for treatment?
It's a very good question, but it is really a terrorizing info. How far we can trust what the nurse tells us? That's a big question, because doctors, I would not expect them to murder the patients, but the fear factor that the doctors themselves may get affected, doctors are forced to work, doctors were not given any protective measures, like gloves and other protective suits or anything, but they were asked or forced to come to the duty. And that situation, some of the doctors may try to murder. It's a terrorizing question. I do not know how far it would be true, but it's possible because it was said in the open by a nurse, I guess. Mm-hmm. I didn't see that video.
Okay.
If it is that video, then I think it's really, we all have worried about.
Yes. So hydroxychloroquine, it's been claimed as one of the best prescriptions to cure coronavirus. Even President Donald Trump is seen talking about it many times publicly. So does that mean one can cure himself with hydroxychloroquine?
The hydroxychloroquine is nothing to do with the COVID-19 at all.
Okay.
Who told President Trump this info, we do not know.
Okay.
Therefore, there is a possibility that someone who doesn't know much about this drug would have told the president, and president would have believed that word and he would have said it. As a politician and a president, he has a lot of responsibilities and he depends on his advisors. He can only consult other people, the so-called subject experts. And most of the subject experts are not really subject experts. Many of them would not have done any research in this type of dangerous viruses. For someone to do research in this type of dangerous viruses, they have to have the access to biosafety level 4 building. That needs almost $1 billion to build, and it's a high-tech facility, and they have to wear the biosafety level 4 suit when they go into that facility. The seat and everything is highly protected, and most of the advisors whom that president have access to may not have exposed to that kind of facility, or even if they have had an access, they would not have done any research. Therefore, they would have suggested that hydroxychloroquine would work wonderfully well for COVID-19. COVID-19 itself was came to the world only in December 2019. That's why it is called COVID-19, 2019. Therefore, until then, nobody did any research. And how did anyone know hydroxychloroquine would work for this virus? Who are the scientists who tested? I don't see anything in the scientific publication. That's why when other people also in the TV, they ask me, this drug will not work or will have not been proved to be, proved to work for COVID-19, or to be tell you the truth, have not been tested anywhere in the world. We need such a facility, and then in that facility, we have to infect some cells with this virus and then administer this drug in the first in cellular level. Then we have to see whether the viral multiplication has been stopped by this drug, and then we have to take it to an animal. That animal has should succumb to this virus, that is, it should die upon infection. Then if you give this drug to those animals after injecting these viruses, if the animal survive, then we can take it to the somewhat higher animal like monkeys, which are closer to the human being. For example, Cynomolgus, it's a strain of monkey whose immune system is very much similar to human immune system, and we have to test it in that animal. Then we have to take it to the human. And human testing, normal people, we need the normal people that we have to infect with this virus. And how many normal people will come forward to inject the virus into themselves?
Yeah.
Or at the most, we can try in already infected people and then try this drug. None of this has been done. None of this research has been done by any scientist in the world. Then how come they say that hydroxychloroquine may work for COVID-19? That is completely misinformed, misled information.
Okay.
Thanks
and
for
speaking about, and speaking about Donald Trump, he also said something along the lines of people should inject themselves with disinfectants. Now, can he say such a statement publicly without consulting a medical expert? Because even an ordinary man, it seems very pathetic, this solution.
Yeah. He is also an ordinary man. He is also an innocent person.
Okay.
And that's why people even like him here, because many people are ordinary people.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, they are also innocent. They do not know anything. Therefore, they like him. And this kind of, when we can disinfect virus and bacteria and kill everything, why not we kill the COVID-19? He doesn't know that the COVID-19 outside doesn't harm anybody. I even told in another recording similar to yours, that we can even cook viruses and eat them. They would be wonderful food material as long as they are outside. But once they enter into the cell, you can use all the disinfectant to kill the person. Right. You can kill the person, then kill the virus. First, the person will die.
Okay. So my next question is, people are seen wearing gloves and masks everywhere whenever they're going around. Of course, I understand by wearing these masks, it prevents us from coming in contact with bacteria or viruses. But my question is it absolutely necessary to wear this when we're stepping out? Is there a high chance of risk if we don't wear it?
Yeah, first, your assumption itself is wrong. It will not protect you from getting infected by a bacteria or virus.
Okay.
Scientists, we use from preventing any splash to fall on our face. That's why we use the mask, not to escape from bacteria and virus. If we, the doctors who do the surgery or something, they wear this mask because they do not want something to fall on their nose. The bacteria and virus, they travel on air. If someone sneezes or coughs, then it will, the virus will get spread like a projectile, like a bullet from a gun. And if they do the coughing, are sneezing, and we are standing next in front of them about 4 to 10 feet, the virus may come and contact us through our nose or mouth or eye, then it will enter into our body. And that's when you can protect yourself. Even the eye itself is a pathway to for the viral entry. How you are going to block all this? Otherwise, the bacteria or the virus that travels in the air when they sneeze, they can enter into our nose or mouth outside the mask, because the mask doesn't fit your body airtight. No, we are not putting a glue around our face and pasting this mask. Just we are wearing that mask. Therefore, if anything liquid or any solid material just fall on your face, they may be prevented. They may be blocked with this mask. Virus entry and bacterial entry, they cannot be blocked by the mask unless you glue it to your face. That's why if you look at the video of scientists working in biosafety level 4, they will wear a complete suit. The air will go inside the suit, pumped by a pump. That pump have to give high pressure to pressurize and inject the air crossing a filter. That filter, HEPA filter, that will be multiple layer of filter that will filter out all the viruses. That is the kind of dress they use. Therefore, if people should not get infected, they should be given that kind of suit. Now, those suits are very expensive. Who is going to buy that kind of dress?
True.
Therefore, it is completely meaningless to use mask to block or getting or to escape from viral infections.
Okay, all right. Now, for this coronavirus, it's usually the small kids and the older people who are more prone to this virus as compared to the middle-aged people. And they seem to be the most vulnerable to this. So what kind of precautionary measures should be taken in order to take care of the kids and the elderly?
There is nothing particular about elderly, because the elderly people have been exposed to so many pathogens, viruses, bacteria, fungi. The longer you live, the more pathogens will enter into our body, because the duration is longer to get exposed to all kinds of pathogens. Therefore, the more and more pathogens come into our body, some of the viruses, they get inserted into our DNA itself and they live forever. And sometimes they even get transferred to the next progeny, our own children and other things genetically. Therefore, the longer we live, exposure to more pathogens make our immune system respond to so many pathogens. Adding one more viral pathogen like this COVID-19 will spoil their immune system to respond properly. Therefore, the immune system it's like a sepsis, a shock, a sudden attack. Therefore, all the immune cells will rush to the area of infection and they secrete so many things and they cause a cytokine avalanche, the cytokines are the immune messengers. They go everywhere and inform the immune cells circulating around our body that I found the virus here. Everybody come here like that. Then all the immune cells will rush to that area and kill the infected cells, release so many things. Our blood vessel itself will become leaky and they will release some of the blood coming out will get clotted, and this clot will reach to your heart, brain, and induce stroke or heart attack and kill the people. Therefore, all the things happen there. It is a chain of events starting from infection. It's not particularly true for elderly people, other than that they have been here on the earth longer time, therefore they might have got exposed to more other pathogens. Therefore, the measures that I have told you are in other videos and other recordings, that they have to be careful in how they eat, what they use their hands for. For example, touching the nose or taking food with the hands. These things can be avoided. Anything that needs a hand to hold, only those things we have to hold with the hand. Food material, we can take it by spoon. Then we can hold the spoon with the hand, but food, we can take it on the spoon and we can eat it. We don't have to put the fingers into our mouth. And some of the South Indian style food, like those are even the North Indian chapati or something, hard material, still we can cut it with a knife or small two forks, still we can eat. There is no absolutely any requirement to use the hands for eating or anything to touch our body until it's absolutely requirement, because we have to always observe our hands. As a scientist, we know when we are going to get exposed. Therefore, the moment we enter into such a lab, we will be aware all the time about what we use our hands for. We use double gloves. We don't remove the gloves with the hand. We remove the gloves with the gloves. We use one glove to take another glove and then put it in hand, and then use the gloved hand to take another glove and put it in another hand. Like that, we are extremely trained, but the people can at least pay attention to their hands. Their hands are the most terrible tool that infects them, other than the airway infection when somebody sneezes or coughs.
Okay. Now I want to ask you, I want to present a scenario in front of you. Let's say we have two small kids, and one child is surrounded in an environment full of dust, you know, going to the playground, playing in the mud, having a lot of fun, and then another child is very careful in the terms that very clean and very hygienic. Now, is there a chance that the child who is playing in the mud and the playground more often has more immunity than the child who is being more careful? Or is this just a myth?
No, it is just the opposite. Okay. The one who gets exposed to more pathogens, of course, it survives, therefore it develops that immunity, but that doesn't mean it's a good thing.
Okay.
When we develop immunity, at the same time, remember, most of the integrative viruses, when they enter into our body, they stay there forever. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the one who remains highly hygienic, that is also going to get the immunity when it gets exposed to the virus. Therefore, the proper way of exposing to the virus is vaccination.
Okay.
But vaccination is very important to be done in a particular way with the proper vaccine. Nowadays, everything that you receive as vaccine are two forms. One, the old virus killed by exposing to the paracetamol, and then so many other toxic chemical added to it. The second vaccine is live virus, mutated, attenuated, live virus. Both forms are very dangerous. They should have been prevented long time back, right from smallpox vaccine. These are all dangerous vaccines. They have to be removed from the society. But governments made laws and forced people to get immunized. That way they even mutated the people. This kind of vaccine may be responsible for the even origin of so many new types of cancers. The immune cell responds to a small fraction of a protein on the cell surface of a virus. Consider, for example, virus as a coconut. You know the shell, and then there will be hair-like thing protruding on the coconut shell. We will cut to open the cell, and we will take the inside, the white material. If you consider that white material as the DNA or RNA of the virus, that is the life material of the virus. But that part, in case of COVID-19 or other RNA viruses, will be completely level and they will get destroyed. Even our sweat from our hand or anything, even our anything will kill the RNA. It is very difficult to protect the RNA. Therefore, this RNA is protected by the shell. You know, the dark black shell around the coconut? That is the thing here in the COVID-19. They are called the envelope protein because they are enveloping. And membrane protein, these are the main type of two proteins. Sometimes these viruses will take our own cell wall and use it to cover its body, and then it will come out. And these are the protective mechanisms that protect the RNA inside the cell. Other than that, there will be some protruding protein like spike protein. And these are the hands for the viruses. They use these hands to get hold of our protein in our cell and enter into our body. And one of these three proteins on the cell surface, that is what the immune system responds to. And a protein will be 300 amino acids, 1000 amino acids, something like that. The spike protein is something like 1200 protein or something, amino acid or something. But immune system recognizes only 8 amino acids. What is amino acid? You consider like a protein as a, consider, made up of some beads, a long chain of beads, and 1000 beads. Then you can color them into different yellow color, green color, black color beads, and you have a nice chain that we can wear it on our neck. But only 8 consecutive beads, the immune system identifies to identify the virus. But in the scientists, we have very much difficulty to identify which one of the 8 amino acids the immune system recognizes. Therefore, what do they do? They don't want to do any research. They don't want to identify what peptide, that small fragment of the protein that the immune system identifies. They inject the whole virus. These viral DNA or RNA are very dangerous. Instead, I developed this technology that you mentioned when you introduced me at Harvard Medical University. This is between 2001 and 2005. I was given a special grant on the, our group was given a special grant on the biodefense project. We were trying to develop the vaccine. There, the idea is to identify that 8 amino acids. When you use that small fragment, like the hair on the coconut, not the entire hair, a small one centimeter fragment of the hair. That's all you need as a vaccine. Why do you put the entire coconut into the body? Those viruses are very dangerous. Even if you mutate some of the portion of the virus, that virus may pick up something from another native infection from another virus, that missing fragment, then it become a live virus, and it will expand and kill the people who have been vaccinated. Where all these testers who did all these tests? And then the corporate company, the vaccine manufacturing company, they combined together, and it's like a conspiracy. I do not know. They want to make money, therefore they inject these viruses. I don't understand the purpose of vaccinating with the whole virus, are killed or attenuated. It doesn't matter. Both forms are very harmful. But the technology that I developed, where I can discover the exact small fragment of the protein on the cell surface of a virus or bacteria, that's all we need as a vaccine candidate. And that is the best vaccine that will not harm any other evil effects, because we are giving only the small protein peptide. The peptide can be broken into pieces when it goes into our body if it is harmful. That is the way that we have to discover the vaccine.
Okay, all right. Now, the next question that I want to ask you is, like you said, when you're vaccinating something, you're injecting viruses into the body. The same goes for pills or tablets that we take inside. These are foreign objects which we take inside the body. So if one wants to heal themselves, how can they do it without the help of medicines or vaccination? Is there any way to heal your body in a very healthy and natural way, or do we have to depend on all these man-made objects?
It's a wonderful question. I really appreciate this question. The reason is that, think about the human or other living species. How many species are there? Billions and billions. How many species you treat with chemical? Can you have an access to? Have you ever gone into the ocean, deep into the ocean, and to catch all the billions of species and inject any chemical? They all live, is that right? And that, because the immune system, every living species on the earth comes with the immune system that will protect itself. And that immune, if anything happens to that immune system, that's when we get the disease. Any cancer or anything, even this black mole that you see on the skin, brown or black mole on the skin, and they all may become cancer, but the immune system kicks in and then stop them from dividing further. Therefore, it remains as a mole there. And this is the job of immune system. When something happens to the immune system, we have to repair the immune system. They need help. Otherwise, they do all the jobs. The chemicals, we don't need them, because if we need them, think about the human being. It is the highest evolved species on the earth. Therefore, if they need a chemical, they could produce them. They never produce any chemical. Then why do we take something far into human body and put it into our human? What happened? Okay, for example, you take a drug, chemical drug, or some herbal extract, and how they are going to affect the medicinal effect? They are going to bind to some human molecule, is that right? That means there is another molecule, human molecule itself, that will bind to the other molecule, producing the same effect. Why don't we discover that human molecule rather than discovering something in the plant or something in some animal or something in the lab by chemical synthesis? They are foreign, they are not required. It is the wrong method of treating any species, not alone human, any species. It is the wrong method. Therefore, this treating human with the human molecules, human proteins. Proteins are the workhorse of any living system. Therefore, if anything happens to the protein, we can repair it by genetically modifying the gene in the lab, not in the body. We should not touch the gene in the body. We have to do it in the lab. For example, you have sickle cell anemia, and hemoglobin will not harvest the oxygen, and your red blood cell will be in problem. Therefore, we can engineer red blood cell and inject into the human. They will not do any harm. And that is the way each mistake of immune system can be corrected by genetically modifying or genetically correcting, I should say, not modify. It should not introduce any other modification, but we have to correct the defects, and we can do it in the lab, proper genetic engineering. Then we can give that engineered protein to treat the disease. That is the right way of treating. But this whole system originated from superstitious beliefs. They didn't know anything. They just saw the plants. They just saw the flowers, fruits, and they tried everything into the human body, hoping that something will cure that patients. Then they started with the chemicals. And if you go to the homeo system, that is completely nonsense. The Avogadro number states that the atomic weight, if you take atomic weight, for example, if you take oxygen, it is atomic weight is 16. In that case, 16 gram of that oxygen will have one followed by 23 zeros, that many atoms. One followed by 23 zeros. And if you dilute it one time, 1 to 10, you take 1 gram of that and put it in 1 ml or 1 liter, then take 10 ml, that is 1 to 100. Take 100 ml, that is 1 to 10. Take 100 ml and put it in another 900 ml. This is 1 to 10 dilution now. You take 1 ml and put it in 9 ml, 1 to 10 dilution. If you do that, again, from diluted one, you take 1 ml and put it on another 9 ml. Second dilution. If you do it 23 times, there won't be any atom in any of the final one. And the arsenic, they did that. The government of India and government of Tamil Nadu, they are giving it free to the people. It is nothing but sugar pill. Because its atomic weight is only now 197, And they, when you do it, the dilution 1 to 100, and that to 30 times? No, if you do 1 to 10, 100, even in 10, 15 times, there will be nothing. You will have only alcohol. If you dilute it in water, only water you will have. That too, this arsenic will not dissolve in water. It will have a very little solubility. It's insoluble. If you have about 100 gram, only 5 gram will get dissolved in even in 75 degree. At room temperature, only 2.5 gram or something will get dissolved. And how this can, and if you do multiple dilution, what you are giving to the patient is finally the water. Therefore, instead of diluting it in the water, they dilute it in the alcohol, and then they put it in the sugar bill. The alcohol itself will get evaporated. Finally, you have what? Nothing. The sugar bill. The lactose from, if you have the milk sugar, and that's what it's made up of. Therefore, that's what you are chewing up as a drug. In this, yeah, like this, there's so many things are going on. People using chemical, they do not know what human molecules this chemical is going to bind to. There are 35 trillion cells in an adult human being. 35 trillion cells. And each cell, how many molecules they have? 20,000 proteins and so many carbohydrates, so many lipids, DNA, RNA, everything. And where exactly this chemical is going to bind to? Did they ever do the research? How can they do the research first? Therefore, it's going to bind everywhere. But what they are looking for is whether this molecule bind to a particular target molecule. You take a gun and you shoot it in the ground, and you always observe whether you shot that particular thief. It's millions of people. You are going to kill everybody, but you are not going to worry about. Until the thief is getting shot, you are going to keep shooting, because you are going to observe only about that particular pickpocket or a criminal. Only you are going to observe whether that guy is getting killed. Oh, he got killed? Yeah, he can't kill, but you already killed a billion people. This is what's going on in science. Scientists are so ignorant. They just want to make money because the corporate company join with them and make them to work with them. And doctors also, they don't know anything. They don't do any research. Therefore, they just memorize it when they go to medical school. When somebody tells them, oh, this, they will read it. They never question it. They never test it. But the scientists, we do. We test. The real scientists, we do. We test and we oppose. We publish that this doesn't work. And the beauty is, suppose you and I, we are scientists and we are doing some research. You are working on some chemical and you are doing some anti-cancer research. I am working on another chemical and I am doing anti-cancer research. The chemical that I worked with, that doesn't do anything. The drug that you worked with that cures cancer, then they will give you Nobel Prize. Why? What did you did different than what I did? I worked on another chemical, you worked on another, your chemical. Do you think that you have some special skill to make that chemical to work against the cancer? No, that's not your character. It is the character of that chemical that did the job. And I discovered that this drug does not work. This is vital information, because thousands of scientists will be doing research. If you don't publish my result, that this chemical will not work. For example, calcium carbonate. This does not work for the cancer. This is very vital information, so that another scientist will not try with the carbonate. They complete the entire scientific publication has been messed up. They think that they can publish only if it works. That means 99.999% it will not work. And those results are gone. They are vital information. Therefore, all the scientists are going to repeat the same failed ones, and they are going to waste their time. The people money is getting wasted. So much the system has to be changed by somebody else. The people should rise up. They should voice out, stop. Whether you are a scientist or a politician, it doesn't matter. Do the right thing. Explain to us. Do not inject anything into our body. Prove it. The people themselves can organize a neutral scientific body. Instead of government forming a regulatory body, the people should come forward. They have to collect scientists from all over the world. 100 scientists are maybe more than sufficient, and they should ask them to test everything. If it is a vaccine, ask them to test whether it is a vaccine, what it will do, what it will not. If it is a chemical, what it will do, what it will not. If it is a herbal extract, what it will do, where it binds, whether it binds to only the target that we hope to bind to, or it binds to 35 trillion cells and what is zillion possibilities. It's all completely nonsense, and this system goes from thousands of years. Okay. Maybe the COVID-19 may open their eyes and brain.
Hopefully, hope so. Now, there's such a hype about coronavirus in the world. When you look at the numbers, the statistics, the number of COVID patients as compared to the number of people all over the earth is just a minute percent, a tiny percent. So why is there such a hype about this virus? Why is everyone talking about it?
Oh, I mean, one thing, this virus is more virulent than the other viruses. Therefore, it may kill more people. But that doesn't mean that it's going to kill 10 out of 1,000. It will not even kill 10 out of 1,000. It's going to kill only a very tiny percentage of the people. But compared to other viruses, it may kill more people. And okay, it's going to kill more people. Therefore, it does follow all the hygienic rule. That's fine. That's wonderful. But why do you try to terrorize people or give some vaccine which is going to cause more problem to the people, as if you are protecting the people and make money? It's money. Then how about the same virus infecting that richest guy and killing him? How is he going to survive? Because the people are the carriers of the viruses, is that right? And the poor people, when they do not have the money to get the vaccine or do not have the money to buy the proper medicine or even buy the food, their body is the factory for the growth of pathogens, because the rich people kept the poor people poor. Therefore, their body is going to grow the pathogens, and these pathogens are going to come out and kill the rich people. These rich people are so stupid, they don't care about anything. They just get the money from the poor people and accumulate into billions. They call themselves our richest person. Why do you say the right word is stupidest person, if there is such a superlative for the stupid or most stupid person? You can call it that way instead of calling richest person. That's what they are. They do not understand. They do not understand science and the disease and the medicines. That's the issue. Therefore, if we all have to live happily, we should have some common facilities or opportunities to available to everybody. Humans can live only together, caring and sharing. Once you take that out and try to rob the people and accumulate somewhere, it's not the people who are going to die fast. You are also going to die fast. This is the message that they should keep it in their brain. See, all the rich guys, are they living now? How many of them died? And cancer or heart attack or stroke? Many of them died. Their billions of dollars, they didn't save them from death. Therefore, the COVID-19 is not going to kill everybody. The people can live happily, but at the same time, take care how they use their hands, whom do they speak to, how far they keep the distance, all the basic security habits. These are all safety habits. Scientists are trained. Now I'm trying to give out in simple words, therefore don't use your hands to touch your nose or mouth. Use your forks or spoon and wash your hands whenever you are going to. Now you don't have to wash your hand every 5 minutes. You can when you are working, use gloves. When you touch your nose or mouth, then you remove the gloves. You are not going to eat food with your gloves, is that right? Nobody will eat. Therefore, when you use the gloves for other work, you know that you have to remove your gloves to eat. That way you are safe. Therefore, use your hands with the care. Then you won't get affected.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Anukant, for sharing your knowledge with us, for educating us on all of this. We're very glad to have you, and please join us again soon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I wish all the people listen to it and then save themselves.
Sure, we do too. Thank you so much.
Thank you.